Frenzy are okay, well, so we tried to say, draw is better than World War. Sure. The only problem is that in the Middle East, weakness is taken as a sign that aggression might be an appropriate response. That is how things work in the Middle East. And the fact that that Joe Biden came into office with an orientation toward continuing Biden, the Obama policies in Iran has led to conflagration, brush fires breaking out everywhere that Iran has. Yoav Galant, the defense minister of Israel, was encouraging Netanyahu's prime minister and the war cabinet, including Benny Gantz. So whenever people talk about the Netanyahu government, that's not what's in place right now. There's unity war government in place that includes the political opposition. The reason I point that out is because there are a lot of people politically who will suggest that the actions Israel is currently taking are somehow the manifestation of a right-wing government. Israel currently does not have a political right-wing government. They have a unity government. In any case, Yoav Galant was urging in the very early days of the war that Israel should turn north. Instead of hitting Hamas, they should actually take the opportunity to knock Hezbollah out. Hezbollah significantly changed the existence of the state of Israel. Then Hamas, I actually agree with that. As far as what Israel has been doing wrong in the actual war, I mean, I think that, again, from an American perspective, I think that Israel is doing pretty well. From an Israeli perspective, if I were Israeli, I would actually want Israel to be less loose about sending its soldiers in on the ground level. So Israel's attempting to minimize civilian casualties, and the cost of that has been the highest military death toll that Israel has had since the 1973 Yom Kippur War. I mean, I personally know, through one degree of separation, three separate people have been killed in Gaza. And that's because they're going in door to door. It's because they're attempting to minimize civilian casualties, and they're losing a lot of guys in this particular war. The problem that Israel has had, historically speaking, is that Israel got very complacent about its own security situation. They believed the technology was going to somehow, nothing was going to change over there. The same thing was true in most of the Donbass, right? That was not going to change. Zelensky's stated goal, and you understand it, he's the leader of Ukraine, right, is that there was a predation on his territory in 2014. And that the Russians sent their little green men across the border, and then they took all of these areas. And so he, as leader of Ukraine, is saying, okay, I want all of that back. Now, the reality is that the U.S.'s interests had largely been achieved in the first few months of the war, meaning the revocation of the ability of Russia to take Ukraine and just ingest it, and two, the devastation of Russia's military capability. I mean, Russia has just been wrecked. I mean, their military is in serious straits because of the war in Ukraine. From an American perspective, I'm very much pro all of that. I think we have an interest in Ukraine maintaining a buffer status against a territorially aggressive Russia. I think that the United States does have an interest in defeating what's going to happen. Say, I'll cross that line and nothing will happen, right, is what people thought. But I'll cross that line, they'll greet me as a liberator, and because the United States just surrendered to Afghanistan, essentially, they won't do anything, and the West is fragmenting, NATO's fragmenting, and all the rest of this, and obviously he was wrong on all of those scores. The problem for Biden is that, as with virtually every war, no end line was set, and so it became out recently, that it was widely reported, that actually there was a peace deal that was on the table in the first few months that Putin was on board with. I think that Biden actually did Zelensky a bit of a disservice, because Zelensky knows where this is going to end. It's not going to end with Luhansk and Donetsk and Crimea in Ukrainian hands. It's just not going to, and he knows that. What actually, in my opinion, Zelensky needed was for Joe Biden to be the person who hoisted that deal upon him, so that he could then go back to his own people and say, listen, guys, I wanted all those things, but the Americans weren't willing to allow me to have them. And so we did an amazing job, a heroic job in defending our own land. We devastated the Russian military, who expected us to, but we can't get back those things because it's unrealistic to get back those things because America, basically, they're a big funder and they're the ones who want the deal. Instead, what Biden said, and this was reported in the Washington Post last year, the Biden administration said, we're going to fight for as long as it takes, as much as it takes. And when they were asked until when, they said, whatever Zelensky says. And that's not a policy. That's just a recipe for a frozen conflict with endless money. Now, it may be that Putin has walked away from the table and that deal is no longer available. If that deal is available right now, I certainly hope that's being pursued behind closed doors. My main critique, again, of Biden is that when you outsource the end goal to another country without stating what America's interest is, that's a problem. I also think that Biden did really quite a poor job of sort of explaining what America's realistic interests are. I don't like it when American leaders, it's weird for me to say this, but I'm not a huge fan of the we're in it to protect democracy kind of rhetoric, because frankly we are allied with many, many countries that are not democracies, and that's not actually how foreign policy works. We should, as an overall, 30,000 for gold, advance democracy and rights where we can.
False, say that they would be duly elected electors that could submit votes to Congress. That was insane. That happened. Asking or begging Pence to accept these false states of electors initially, and then just say we should just throw it out completely and throw it to the House delegation, which was majority Republican. That was absolutely unbelievable. And then on the day of January 6th, trying to capitalize on the violence by him, transfer of power. That was the goal from start to finish. Whether it was through false claims, whether it was through illegal schemes, or whether it was through violence on the Capitol to delay the certification.
So, I'm glad you're excited. It's always fun. There are two elements to incitement of insurrection. One is incitement, the other is insurrection. So, incitement has a legal standard, so does insurrection. Neither of those things. So, if you're asking me, morally speaking, did Donald Trump do the right thing between November 4th and January 6th? I said, I will continue to say no, he did not. I think he was saying things that are false, with just actually false, about his theories with regard to the election, about the election being stolen, about fraud. Adjudicated in court, did not even bring many of the claims that he brought publicly and all the rest of that. If we're talking about incitement of insurrection, the legal standard doesn't mean anything. When it comes to incitement, it has to be immediate incitement to immediate lawless action. That's the standard for incitement. And I'm very meticulous in how I use this because I have to speak publicly a lot, and that means there are lots of people listening to me, which means some of those people are probably crazy. And some of them may go and do a crazy thing. Did I incite them? The media tends to use the word incitement very loosely with regard to this sort of stuff, in the same way that Bernie Sanders incited the congressional base. He did not. Bernie Sanders has a lot of things I disagree with. I think Bernie's a schmuck. Doesn't matter. He did not incite that. So saying bad things is not the same thing as inciting violence. Inciting violence, the legal standard of the United States is, I want you to go punch that guy in the face. That's insane. With regard to insurrection, typically in insurrection, there are some descriptions in case law, though none in statutory law, as far as I'm aware. The typical description in case law is the replacement of one legitimate government of the United States with another by violent means. The notion that Donald Trump coordinated any such insurrection is belied by the FBI itself. The FBI put out a report in August of 2021 suggesting that there was no well-coordinated insurrectionist attempt coordinated by the White House. In fact, what you had was Donald Trump thrashing around like that weird alien in the movie Life. I don't know if you ever saw it with Jake Gyllenhaal, where he's like kind of thrashing up against a glass box, just an alien just thrashing. That I think is more what you were seeing from November 4th to January 6th. And then, again, the claim that January 6th itself was an insurrection. So, virtually, I'm not sure that anyone was charged with actual insurrection. There were some people charged with seditious conspiracy. There are insurrection statutes that do exist. No one was charged under those particular statutes. There were some people who, say, informally had insurrectionist ideas. Those would be the people who wanted to hang Nancy Pelosi or kill Mike Pence. And those people are in jail right now. And the election...
He's loaded up on crabs. I don't even want to ask how he did that. Alright, good read. Can you put him OS? Okay, that's huge. Poe has some opportunity. Nice. Gets the chip. Gets the headshot. Two headshots away from the floor here. He's brought himself back into this round. There it is! Huge comeback from Tote there, and like I said, I think Buffet Brawler didn't watch his stamina well out there. It looks like he made some overconfidence on a huge HP lead. Kind of threw that round away. There was no reason to miss the opportunity to get back into the round there.
You lost, Zane.
44 damage. Oh, he could have got the guard break there, but he just wanted to be safe, I think. Nice light parry, though, retakes the house lead. Now, that's a good trade for Tote. That is not only is it more damage, but he's got more HP, which means it's even better as a percentage. Put him in there! Oh, the good read by Buffet Brawler brings it back 7-5. I mean, yeah, but more, but I mean, it's part of the matchup. At the end of the day, it's just part of the matchup. You've got to be careful. Light connects. Buffet Brawler bringing the back here. Was a three-round disadvantage. 21 now. We'll be seeing Buffet Brawler be making a bit of a comeback here, chat. Recovery. out of stamina here. Just get another 15. That's good. Nice, gets the parry. Gets the stamina finish. Ah, oh, another 15 headbutt. Oh, this is what I mean, chat. Just look at this. Like, it doesn't even seem like the warlord's done much, right? He's got a couple of headbutts, got a heavy parry punish. All of a sudden, he's got HP lead. Or he's brought it back to even after a big HP disadvantage. Oh, side heavy, they're both 1 HP, chat. Baits out the side dodge light. Keeping his cool there. You can see, I think this is actually something you can kind of tell between these two players. Buffet seems a bit more prone to panicking. That's the second time he's throwing out that panic side dodge light there. Where it's good read there on the faint guard break as well by Toe. That's the UV rip as well. You can tell Toe, he's feeling himself now. He's in the zone. He's in the rhythm. He's in what I call the schmix up read state. Kind of like 86. But for honest. He's taking all the read. Okay, Toad does finally make a bad read.
For instance, I think there is a chance, I don't think it'll happen because of the polling that's now, but if Trump didn't get the nomination, I think he should say screw it and run as an independent. He thinks he can win.
I doubt that he would do that, but theoretically.
Possibly.
Yeah.
I mean, again, Trump has, he was really content to throw Georgia, the two runoff along the game of the bus. Is to support him for the election.
So what is all this in service of? What's the generalized argument that you're making? Do you believe, I'll go back to my question, do you think that if Trump wins, there will be no more elections? What percentage do you think that that's a reality?
If Donald Trump wins, I think there is a 100% chance that he can try to prevent peaceful transfer of power. In terms of, would he succeed?
I can guarantee you he will not do that.
Why is that?
Because he's in the second term.
Now going to be barred from the ballot. It's probably not healthy for us. Because then what?
You want to talk about threats to democracy? That would be a pretty serious one applied across
would,
the board, by
it,
the way.
It would be. However, like, that threat to democracy was earned by Donald Trump and the conservatives that supported him. I think conservatives made a dangerous gamble when they threw Trump into office, and now, like, all of the fallout from that is something that we all, as Americans, have to deal with.
I mean, I think that the unprecedented legal theory that a state can simply bar somebody from the ballot on the basis of, in an informal way, believing that he is, quote-unquote, an insurrectionist, is pretty wild. I mean,
say it's pretty wild, but there is an amendment in the Constitution, the 14th Amendment, that says that if they have engaged in this, they shall not be, or you shall, I don't remember the phrasing because it doesn't require conviction, but it's a self-executing, arguably, thing.
If we're getting into constitutional law, I mean, there are a number of provisions that suggest that this is, number one, not self-executing. I mean, minority opinions in the Colorado Supreme Court case are pretty thorough. The number one contention, which is that this is not self-executing, define insurrection as a criminal activity so that somebody could theoretically be convicted of insurrection and therefore ineligible to run for office. It is unlike, say, the analogs that are used by the majority opinion, like age. Obviously, this is not the same thing. We can all tell what somebody's age is by looking at their birth certificate. I can't tell whether somebody's an insurrectionist without any reference to a legal statute or a definition of the term.
I would also be careful with that because remember, one of Trump's first, like, big political actions was to
certificate.
I like that you both said 100% chance that Trump will try to go for third term and 0% chance, which statistically.
Third term, he's done, man. Are you kidding?
I didn't want to.
Trump's going
to
walk around, hands up high, and be like, I'm a two-term president. I'm the only president since Grover Cleveland who would know. But since Grover Cleveland, who served two non-consecutive terms, I kicked Joe Biden out of office, and I kicked Hillary Clinton out of office. Dude would be like, he'd be living large. Are you kidding? He doesn't want the presidency anymore after that.
I just think that I think it's scary that, like, Donald Trump. It feels like for all of the accusations that are made sometimes against Democrats, like Biden is ordering Garland to investigate Donald Trump and blah, 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 it seems like Donald Trump would actually do that with his DOJ, would give them orders.
He didn't.
Well, he kind of did, though, later on. That was, I only rebuked when I think, like, half the White House does.
Okay, so that's a slightly different topic because now you're getting into all the election shenanigans and all this, but...
Trump threatened to fire his acting attorney general if he wouldn't carry the same plot for him, essentially. Like, if Trump could order his DOJ to do something, would he? It's not beyond the pale for him, right?
It's not beyond the pale for him to order them to do it. And then
Ah!